Hey YouTube, I'm not sure what the heck was going on with the audio in that last video. I apologize, and I'm here to correct it. I'm here to correct what's wrong. So hopefully this looks good, and we're gonna get back into some business with some XBIN config. So in essence, we have a nine-step process here. It requires using DOSBox, a tool in DOS called Fontraption, Moebius with a special build for the fonts fork, then a combination of saving in Moebius as XBIN and reloading into Pablodraw with XBIN format to maintain that font, and then using Pablodraw as our editor of choice because you can change colors in it. So in this way, you can get sort of a modern ANSI set up with your own custom characters and your own color schemes and everything. So I'm hopeful that, first of all, that the audio is good on this one and that we can kind of move at least what I'm doing with text mode art to the next level. So the one thing we don't have as a result of this is the half block mode in Moebius because Pablo just doesn't have that. However, we can compensate for the reference image by using a program to complement Pablodraw, and maybe I'll make a video on just that later, but it's called Pure Ref, and it lets you basically load an image, resize it to your specifications, lock it in place so that your input doesn't move anything on that window. In its essence, it's frozen, but then you can adjust the transparency above. So you're drawing underneath, basically. It's like an overlay program, which is neat. Right. So let's first start with the thing that I want to get out of the way right away, and that is this is a nine-step process where only the first through fourth steps are required if you're setting up a font for the first time. Okay. If you're not making a font, then it's only loading your font into Moebius and then exporting as an XBIN and then loading that again in Pablo. Now, if you're doing the whole thing, then it's a nine-step process, but it's not that bad. It's actually pretty easy. Okay, so this is not an ideal situation, but because of limitations in Moebius that exist currently, we need to do this in order to use custom colors and a custom font in a way that is more modern. Now, there are other programs out there that let you do something like this, one of which is called Artworks, another is Empathy. And so you can do it in DOSBox. I just don't really, I don't groove on those programs. And so, right. So why am I doing this at all? There's another program called ArtRage that, I hope it's okay if I call him this, my friend, Polydux, whom I've met through the Misty Gris Discord server, and I'll put a link in the description. He makes, or I'm not even sure if it's a he, I don't know, but that person makes artwork that is just totally inspiring and awesome. And so I recently also met someone in that channel who, well, before I move away to from Polydux, so Polydux is awesome. Parenthetically, end of story there. But and it's actually not a but, it's an and. He has this thing called text mode friends, and it's a bunch of people who do other things besides strict ANSI. I hope I'm not getting that wrong. Like they do any kind of artwork that is similar to a cellular based glyph kind of thing on a grid. So yeah, anyway, I met someone through Mystigris in his name or her name, I again don't know. And it doesn't matter. It's beautiful that we live in a time where we can be on such close contact with someone and not even know what gender they are. The thing that matters the most is the spirit and the soul. And that comes through regardless. And it's coming through as text on Discord. Anywho, what I wanted to tell you is that this person, Dwimmer, is a aspiring newcomer to text mode, and they are awesome because their spirit is so beautifully unjaded and unnegative. It's just like it's like this person is coming alive to witness the things that we've all been doing for the past little while. Okay, so in that light, I created something using a program called Petmate, and that's what this is here. This specific thing is using a Petski font, which you can see over here on this side. The issue with this, well, actually, let's discuss its merit, okay? So the merit is it's gorgeously displayed in a full screen on my 1080p monitor here, which I know isn't the latest and greatest, but to me, this is enough. And if you look down here, right here, let's see if I can zoom on this guy. Okay, well, maybe that was a... Oh, no, here we go. So here's the 40 by 25 thing. And you can see here, hopefully, we'll find out together, but you can see that the columns are 40. And that means that it's using 40... a grid of 40 across and 25 down. And you can, I thought maybe there was a way to turn that grid on. Maybe not. Maybe I'm thinking of a different program. I've used so many in the past little while that I don't recall. Anyways, so I got inspired and, you know, made this because I was witnessing what Dwimmer was doing. And I was like, wow. And I also had previously seen what Polydux was capable of. And I was like, oh my goodness. Here's the issue with Petski, in my opinion. Now, I'm not calling exception on this and saying ANSI is better. That's not what I'm saying, because it isn't. They're both this. They're both very similar, okay? But what I am going to tell you is you can't do certain things in Petski, at least within this program and at least to my knowledge, and I've done some research trying to figure it out. You can't have more than one background color in your whole drawing. So as a refresher, you can choose colors over here for the foreground, but over here, you can only have one background color. Now, that's... so just coming from a long, long use of ANSI, I can't tolerate that, especially when I can see I could make this so much nicer by just having the ability to have this little cyan color triangle on top of this purple field, this background here. And so this really just, but it lit the rocket of inspiration, and we're up in the stratosphere sailing. And then we realize, oh wait, you can do this with ANSI. ANSI supports those background colors. Ah, okay. But knowing what we know about ADF and ANSI 2 from Hoopty back in ArtRage days or Artworks days, sorry, ArtRage is a completely different thing. I know that those programs are a little unwieldy. So I also know that I prefer to use Windows instead of DOSBox if I can to draw, just because it makes my life a little easier. The good news is that this is possible thanks to a new build of a new build of Moebius that is using a custom code base from let's find it. I'm gonna open the page here. First of all, let's go to Moebius, and then I'll explain this in a hot minute. So DOSBox doesn't need any explanation, but Moebius might. So Moebius is a program, well, you can see right here. Let's just scroll down here. But Moebius is a new ANSI and ASCII editor for macOS, Windows, and Linux. So right there, it's an ANSI editor that's new for three operating systems, the most popular ones, The major feature that differentiates it from Pablodraw is the half-block brush, which allows editing in a closer style, or in a style closer to Photoshop than a text editor. What this means is, I've already created a video on this, but it means that you can draw as if it were a pixel program, but it's already in a text format. Although you can still use the function and cursor keys to draw with also, which is really an important thing because in my experience, using another program, which is, Rex Paint, you can't use the cursor as easily, at least the way that I understand it so far. Rex Paint can do all of the background colors and the foreground colors and the font and everything. And it's a great program on its own. It has its own merits and stuff. I can't figure out how to use it in the way that I'm used to drawing for years and years and years. So what I really need is Pablodraw, ideally Moebius, but Pablodraw, to be able to support these custom fonts. That's it. That's really all that we're looking at here. So let me go to another, and for some reason my hotkeys don't work anymore, so that's sweet. Let me load up the next website, which is where the magic begins to happen, even more so than the default magic of Moebius itself. Okay, there is a site that is the Glyph Drawing Club blog. And the Glyph Drawing Club is awesome. I'm not even going to open that because the amount of awesome is significant and I would get distracted even more so than I am in my normal way of working. But what needs to happen is that we need to read. And reading is hard because we're so excited. So, Moebius ANSI and ASCII Art Editor with custom font support. Dude. That is amazing. And I'm really glad that people found this program and are like taking it forward. Blocktronics is the one group I believe that owns it. And anyway, I'm not gonna try and, you know, talk about all that, but credit due to Andy H, who is the maker of Moebius, and credit due to the Glyph Drawing Club people who have forked the code. Or found somehow the code that was forked or whatever and shared it with the world in a way that is just like not a secret and everybody can participate. That's awesome. Also, huge props to Ito, Curtis Wensley, the maker of Pablodraw, and all of the godfathers and godsisters and godmothers and, people who came before that created the text mode that we use today. So going back to the website. So this is a lot of text to read, and that's fine, but look at this. This right here is the awesomeness. So this font right here was created probably using Empathy or something like it. I don't know. But what you see here are these other glyph characters. So if I go back to PetMate real quick, this is what separates Petsky, the character set, is what separates the ability to draw in a different way, to emote in a different way, using only text for Petsky. And you can use these different colors. The colors are also part of that magical medium, as well as the size of your canvas. So in this case, it's a 40 by 25. However, you can do different sized canvases. Even the Commodore had, I believe, an 80 column mode that could be used. So anyway, but I like it like this. This is how I like it. Okay. So anyway, this here is the program Moebius, right? It's the one that we were at before. And this is like Pablodraw, but it has that half block mode. Now, Andy H, he stopped kind of working on it, and that's fine, because wow, what a contribution anyway. Thank you so much. But now it's kind of just been stale and stalled out. So these awesome people added this support. So this is a format called XBIN, and that's something that Empathy, and way longer before that, I believe, or maybe around the same time, artworks by Hoopty was a thing, and ADF format came, and ANSI 2, and a bunch of other things. And so the text medium has always been evolving, even long ago. So how does this work? So first, you download from here a custom version of Moebius. And when you do this, you click this link, you'll see Google Drive. Now here you grab one for Windows, which is the EXE. This is the portable EXE, I believe, because it runs without modification or necessity of a setup EXE. The .deb is for Linux, and the .dmg is for OS X. So, yeah. And you can see, oh, and Viler, who made this awesome old school PC font pack. He is also the guy who made the font editor that we're going to show in a minute. But basically, how do you do this stuff? Well, you download that custom version, install Moebius, go to new file, change font. Okay, so let's first open our custom Moebius that we've previously downloaded. And the way that I'm going to do this is I'm going to put this poster frame up so that I don't make a mess of my screen. And that's not what I wanted. Already I'm making a mess. So I have a file manager here that is called, let me put this back on, Total Commander. And this is a great program for people who like to pane file explorers. Not going to go into that. But basically, you go to where you create your shortcut. And this is important to understand for a couple of reasons that I'll go into later on. But basically, you have Moebius. Okay. And the Moebius that you use is the one that supports fonts. And of course, it's not going to work because I am a dummy. Hang on a minute, and I will fix this problem. So as I'm fixing the problem, what I would like you to understand is, okay, here we go. This zip file that you download or whatever, at least on PC, from the Google Drive, I downloaded everything just so I had it. So here's what I'm going to do. Instead of making this a shortcut, I'm just going to copy this in and be done with it. Then I know it's going to work. And this will also show you guys that you can run it from a standalone executable. This will also let me stop feeling like an idiot because I'll be successful and articulate on what I'm trying to say. Okay, it's going to load in a minute. It doesn't take that long, I promise. All right, so this is Moebius. You just create a new file, and then I've got to reset my zoom level. This is because I was approximating 40 columns. I'm going to reset everything as well. I was approximating 40 columns. So now we have our character set here, and it's all the default. This is default plain old plain Jane IBM ANSI, right? Okay, so got that. All right. So you just go back to Moebius, and then you can change the font. So if you go to View, and you choose Change Font, and then from here, you can pick a different font. There are all these defaults that you can choose from, which are great. Some of them are better than others, but this is where Viler's old school PC font pack was added in by the people who made this custom build of Moebius. And this is really neat. It's really, really, really neat. So I'm just going to pick a random character set. And you can see it's quite different. Like, look at the funkiness. I'll just type something. Look at this funkiness. Funkiness. That is some funkiness right there. Look at those characters. How specifically awesome is that, first of all? And I'm going to go into 200% to give you a better understanding of this. I'm also going to hide the preview window just so we can see good stuff going on. Okay, so that's neat, because now if I go back to View and I go to reset call default font, you see how it lost all of its funkiness. That's not as good as the other one for our purposes of demonstration. So let's choose a different one. Let's choose the police. This is the police. And we're going to make it red because police. Come out with your hands held high. And I'm going to make the police blue. This is the police.
Wee.
Okay, so you get the general idea. So view reset default font will take you back into the safe waiting arms of the defaults. Okie dokie. So that's how that works. Now that's all built in. This is where the real evolution begins. There is the ability to load custom fonts into Moebius. And you can see the instructions here. So you basically use that same menu, view, but here you choose custom font. That right there opens up a massive, massive difference in the program. The palette of characters can be customized to what you need or what you like. So in that regard, you, as an ANSI artist, using the tools that you're familiar with from years and years, can use Petsky if you want. And what does that mean, children? What does that mean? And I don't mean that in a way to hurt children, because that's not what I mean. You could have that light blue field background with the light cyan triangle that you want right here, just so it doesn't have this abrupt stair step. Now, that's a lot of work to make that happen, but you need to realize, like, there's other compromises that are going on in here that I'm just not willing to settle for. So I'm not the only one, because look, these people are way more awesomer than me. And look at all of the things that they've documented. So how to use custom fonts. Install Moebius, use a load custom font. Got it. Now, it supports any bitmap font with extensions F06, and it looks like evens up to F32. Large scale fonts, files that have F32, break the UI a little bit, but should still be usable. The optimal size is F16, and that's what we're going to use. And I don't mean like Maverick's airplane. I mean .F16 as in 16 rows per character cell. That is 16 high pixels. The ultimate old school PC font pack is just a huge list of font not organized in any way. Yep. And then you should save your files as XBIN files. This part is super key, but it's also a little bit... I'll just keep going. It didn't work for me when I did it this way from Fontraption. The custom font option is not thoroughly tested. I haven't found any bugs, so whoever made this, you are the man, woman, child, alien life form of the 2021 for me. The custom font option is also not tested when doing a joint session over the network. Okay, so this is important because this is one of the things that the person that I mentioned previously, Polydocs, asked about. He said, hey, can you do the networking thingy? And it looks like you're not able to. So net, here's what needs to happen. Moebius people, awesome folks of the internet, we ask you humbly if you can please just add custom color support, add the ability to do the things that you've already given us ways to do in solo mode and as individuals. Please, internet persons of talent and superpowers, allow us to have this option over the network without any compromise. Okay. So anyway, blah, blah, blah. So you can export the font file from the view export font. And this is something that once it's in Moebius, they're talking about. You can also share artwork online to share online XBIN. That is pretty neat. Okay, so they're trying to make it easy as possible. It's still not that easy. And I say this with peace and love. Some of the people who draw text mode art are not exactly rocket scientists, which is funny to me, because the amount of complexity that we had to master to create artwork using text was significant. Like, anyway, that's a separate topic. But I'm making this video in the hope that, one, if I ever forget how to do this, I can just look at YouTube, and YouTube's still around, and I can find my video, and I remember there's a YouTube. Two, other people probably will need this kind of handheld guide to get through it. Okay. Given all of those things, and the fact that the original version of this video was rushed and a horrible audio quality, I felt like I had to elaborate a bit and just kind of take the time to go through it all for love. All right. So this is the program Fontraption. So how do you get this program? First of all, you need DOSBox if you're running on Windows or Linux or Mac. Any of those things support DOSBox. And then you go here, and this is the Viler guy. Yeah, Viler is the man. Viler is, he's the man or woman or what I said, the gender agnostic entity that created this thing. Look at this. You can has Eddie in yours. That's pretty neat. Like, and also, Viler, I just got to give you mad props here. Like, this right here is, this makes you like 10 times awesomer than just your regular awesome level. I mean, come on. That's amazing. Okay. Right. So, you download it from here, and then you use DOSBox to open it. Now, this is where things get a little bit confusing. And this is where I'm hoping that the extra handholding will be appreciated. So back in Total Commander here, you can see I've got a shortcut. And my shortcut has a target of CDOS, DOSBox, EXE. And then I'm passing in double quotes. This is important if there are spaces or illegal characters. Otherwise, that would break the parser of whatever runs these things. And I'm pointing it to my installation of where I have frapped.com installed. So I'll go ahead and copy this to the clipboard. Right? Well, actually, I want to copy it from without the .com file. That's the program, by the way. It's a .com. That was a different type of executable that you could create in DOS way back when. Okay, so now I'm going to go over here, and I'm just going to paste this guy in, and you'll see this is where I unzipped my copy of this file that I downloaded. Okay, that's all that is here. Now, yours is not going to have this, or this. That's stuff I made. So just know that that won't be in there for you. But what I was getting at is the thing that matters is how do you create a shortcut to open this program without going through the rigmarole of DOS every time. So to do that, it's really simple. You just take your shortcut to DOSBox, find out where it's installed, and then run it. And then you pass in the full path and file name as it exists on your computer. And then you add dash no console in it, your option. You can add full screen at the end. Now, I'm actually going to leave this because you can get out of full screen by hitting Alt Enter, but I like full screen. You can also see that I have some other programs here where these might also be helpful. And maybe someday I could go through and show you how some of these other ones like Pablodraw works. I've already made a Rex Paint video. Artworks is an interesting one. Anyway, squirrel detection is kicking off. My squirrel sense. Okay, so that's how you set it up. Then once you open it, which you do by double clicking it, and I want to see if my my stream is working here. It looks like it is, and the audio is fine. And but it's showing it up in the top left corner, whereas I'm seeing it in a full display. So I'm going to go ahead and exit this full screen thing. And this is not an uncommon thing to happen wherein you have a bunch of screen layout issues after. Okay, so let's actually go back to my desktop here so I can make it a little bit nicer for us to see on. All right, I am going to actually zoom in, and hopefully this works for the world so that you guys can see this a little better. Now, this specific magnifier is showing me a bigger version than what you guys are seeing probably. I actually have another program called Glass Brick that I could use instead just to be sure, but let's just try this first. Okay, so this is that program, Fontraption, and it lets you edit the fonts. That's really what it is. So you can see in this program, you have a whole bunch of options. The other thing that you should note is look at the version is here, and this is the last time it was updated. So that was last year, guys. That's pretty awesome. So I don't know if we have coronavirus to thank for Viler having the time to do this, or if he you know, was inspired before this. I don't know. I didn't take time to look, but I just want to say thanks again, Viler. This is really cool. And if you didn't make the program, thanks to whoever did. Okay, so you have a dual kind of way of working with this program. You have this side here, and you have as many high here as your font has. So first of all, this is the default VGA font, and we know that because if we hit Control G, we can choose which VGA font to get from the program. Okay, so we know, first of all, that we're dealing with the VGA font. The second thing that we know is that there is a character set in this zoomed in view, and as we move our cursor, well, it doesn't necessarily update the left side. It does look like this is how you engage the editor. So if we move our cursor with left and right arrows, and you can see that's how you do it with move, left, up, down, right. So now I'm going to go to B. Ah, so you hit enter to select the one that you want. Or you can press G and you could do like Z, which is neat. Or you can choose space also. It's not just enter, it's space or enter. This right here is the enter icon. If your keyboard doesn't have it, take my word for it. Right. The other thing that we know is now that we have these two modes, we can see character, and font, and we hit tab to go between them. This nice UI exists to show us what is in focus. So here, as we move our cursor, we're in this character set mode. Here over here, we can use our cursor to be in the pixel mode, per pixel, per character. So this is like a big sprite sheet in pixel terms, or in pixel art terms. This is like a big sprite sheet. The entire character set is, then you go into each sprite and you can go ahead and turn the pixels on and off. Now you don't have colors or anything like that, but you don't need it because the programs that you load these fonts into are the ones that have the color. Okay, now that I've done that, I'm going to turn off the magnifier, first of all, because it's becoming unwieldy for me. Second of all, because I want to be able to see my OBS studio on the other screen to make sure everything's running as we hope. Okay, so Net, too long, didn't read, didn't listen, too long, didn't watch, TLDW, you use Control S or F2 to save, Control L or F3 to load. You can import, and when you import, this is where you can import a bitmap file. See, you can import .com files, bitmap files, or XBIN files. Ooh, that's pretty awesome. That is pretty awesome. Now, one more thing I want to talk about here before I go further, and this is about DOSBox. So let me minimize this for a moment. And the reason I want you to understand this is because it's important for your files. So I'm opening DOSBox just from the start menu shortcut. And this is the default DOSBox. Now I've tweaked a little bit of the settings, but it's generally the same. So when I choose Control L from here, you can see I only have two disks. I have my drive C, and then I have what I can see is the current directory. And then I have these other ones, okay? Now Z is default DOSBox stuff. So if I go in here, you'll see a bunch of DOSBoxy things. We don't care about that. We want to be in here. The other thing that I want to show you is that when you open or run a program from DOSBox using Total Commander, not Total Commander, but this method where you pass in the shortcut like this, in your shortcut, and you put all these things in, it will by default mount. And this is the important part. It will, that's not what I want. Where's my program? Here. I don't, what is this I'm looking at? What is that? I don't even know. Wait. Oh, so it will by default load or mount a C drive on your behalf, and it will point the root of that C drive to the directory in which your executable that you're launching from the command line from your shortcut is started. Therefore, you don't have a parent directory. This is the root, okay? If I go here, it's the root. Now, I want to show you how you can circumvent this, and it's only a little bit more trickery, in which this is the generic DOSBox, okay? Now, here you can do mount. There's a command called mount, and if you do mount /?, it will tell you what to do. For right now, we don't even have a C drive on this specific DOSBox. But if I go mount and I type C space, so We're following the usage mount space drive letter, which is drive C, and then we're going to put the local directory. So in this case, okay, I want to put my Dropbox in here. So I'm going to do B:\Dropbox, and this is just my own thing. So now if I go to C drive, I see the contents of my entire Dropbox. Now if I go to, what is it, font, BIR, no, that's something else. No, but these, well, the what I'm telling, showing you here is that Fontraption can do the same thing. So let me do it up. Let me copy my Fontraption directory into my Dropbox. One moment, and I'll do that by going here. There's a neat trick you can do if you go to Properties. You can open File Location, and that will open your Windows Explorer. In this case, it's not the greatest because it's finding DOSBox, which is the target of the executable. But what we actually want is this guy right here. We actually have him over there. Well, how convenient is that? So now we're going to go to Dropbox. I'm just going to copy in my Fontraption folder. And if all goes well, it looks like maybe it doesn't have, yeah, it's so it has to be remounted, I think. And there might be a way to do this, like a refresh or something. But what I'm going to do instead is just exit, because we know turning it off and on again will always work, because that's what Moss said and Roy said in the IT crowd. And that's great advice. So now if I do mount C, B, Dropbox, I can see that I now have, oh, there we go. There's our Fontraption. Now, if I open it from this way, I get the same thing. You saw that thing in the back here. Let's go back there for a moment. This is the console that we don't open by default when we pass dash no console. Okay, so just minimize that part if you want. Or you can create just a generic DOS box to start with no console, and you'd get the same effect. Okay, so but what I'm demonstrating here now, this is our one that we had originally, which is locked in place to just what we have with C drive root is frapped.com and where that's installed. Now, if we go over here and we go into C and we go back, look at all of this stuff. And we're okay. So now we can do. Let's go to fonts text mode. Look at that. Okay. All right. So now what you can do is basically you can move freely about the drives that you have and whatnot. Okay. So I just wanted to show you that. For now, I'm going to close this guy out, but everything else applies to what I'm going to show you in this window as it would in the other one. The only difference is that this is locked to have the C drive root to the same directory that frapped exists in. Great. I'm going to hit escape. I don't want to load anything. However, if I choose import here, you can see there are examples. So in the import folder, there's a bunch of examples. There's BIMPs, there's COMs, and there's XBs. XBs are XBINs. BIMPs are bitmaps. And COMs are command files or COM files from DOS. So let's first try flight mirror. Ooh, spooky. This must be Fairlight from a loader of some kind, I would imagine. But what you can see, in the same way that we said, stop, this is the police. You can edit these things. So let's try a ASCII, not a raw binary font. Okay, what about blue term? Okay, now I'm doing load font. Oh, remember there's import, guys, don't forget. A ASCII. Look at that beautifulness. Look at that. How amazing is our world that this happens to us, that we can do these things. We can rescue our old machines because of everybody having so much love for them. Okay, so now it's important to understand here. You can do export, and you can export it as these different formats. This didn't work for me to load it into Moebius. What I had to do instead was just save it, and I'm going to call this a ASCII. .f16, because the reason I'm calling .f16 is because that's the height here. Okay, that's the character height. Let's import some more things. How about blue term? Blue term looks like VGA, but an IBM version. So what? Sure, let's grab blue term. And we're going to export, or we're going to save it again. Control S, blue term, .f16. Oh, no, but that's a 12-point font. So let's control S and call it F12 instead. Okay, what else do we have? Let's see, we have CTXBIN. Okay, now we're getting somewhere. This here, look at these. These are a font that someone way cooler than us made way back when. And I think this might be one of those fonts that we definitely want to have a play with. So I'm going to go ahead and save this. But before I do, I want to note the height. It's 16. Okay. So this is, what was this called? Let's load it, or let's import it again just so we can be sure. CTXBIN. Okay. So we're going to do Control S, CT-XBIN. I'm using uppercase just because I'm in DOS and I want to venerate my feeling of nostalgia. I used to use uppercase a lot because it's easier for me to read. So dumb. Okay, so let's import some more. What else we got? Dual font. 512 character XBIN font. Import part 1 or 2. Did not know this. I guess let's import part 1 and see what magic lives in part 2. So the XBIN standard must have allowed additional character set in memory. So we're going to save this and we're going to call it dualfont1.f16. And then we're going to do the import again. And we're going to do part 2. Okay. This looks a lot like VGA, but I don't think it is. It's slightly different. So it's probably whatever the person had who made this, or whatever program they were using who made this font. At the time when they made it, it's probably their BIOS character ROM or something, or the program's default. Okay, sidebar, let's keep going. So we have Eddie. That is incredibly cool. So, I mean, I don't have words to describe how neat this is, but one thing is, this is a bitmap, right? So let's real quick, let's see how big this bitmap is. And go back to our total commander here, go to import, and we're just going to look at Eddie here, and let's see how big he is. I thought there was a thing that showed you the resolution. Perhaps I am mistaken. I think there is. I'm just not savvy enough with. Okay, so it's. It's trying to do something here to tell us, but it's not actually working. Okay, so I'm going to go back to the one that I like that I made, and we're going to do this a different way. We're going to use Alt Enter, and we're going to show details. Okay, it is 128 wide by 256 tall. So why is this interesting? Well, because what you can do, if I go to my drawing directory, and then I go to my graphics 2 directory, where I have my graphics 2 installed, and then I go into my, actually, it looks like there's a 2.5 in progress. This doesn't really make any difference, but I'll just open it this way. 2.5 work in progress. So I'm going to load that into graphics 2 for a moment. And to do that, I'm going to go all the way back here. It doesn't look like you can do it that way. So I'm just going to go pop. Oh, it crashed. Actually, I don't know why. That's fun. Well, anyway, let's use, what other programs do we have here? Let's use ASprite. And I actually have it through Steam now. So this is when I bought it off of the website they had there. But I have it in Steam now. So let me go to my art programs. ASprite. It's going to open Steam. There's other options, obviously, including you can see some things that I was playing with in DOSBox, Autodesk Animator, Deluxe Paint 2 Enhanced, Deluxe Paint Animation. And I've been messing also with Amiga pixel editors, thanks to another guy I met on Discord, or a person. I don't know if they're male or not. And it's still loading. I have a slower computer. You're going to have to be patient. Just a moment. Okay. So I'm going to just go file. Actually, with Ace Sprite, I can just do this. I can go to back and I can grab Eddie and then grab from the icon and I can Alt Tab and then put up. There she is. Look at that. Now, here's the thing. You know, when we are doing our font, we're looking at a grid that we know there's 16 pixels per character. And we also, well, we don't know, but we can assume there's 8 across. Let's count them. Looks like 4. Yeah, so 8. So theoretically, in Ace Sprite, if we go to Edit, wait, now it's under View Grid. Grid settings. So we're going to make a grid that is 8 by 16. Now, wow. What do we have here that is cool? So let's put this side by side for a moment, and I want to demonstrate this for a minute. And it might be possible that there's a guide. Oh, neat. That's a new feature I did not realize. And I'll bet you these stay here where you put them. How amazingly cool is that? And you just get rid of them by doing that. I also realized, maybe I didn't. I don't know what I did there. Anyway, what I'm showing you, like, let's look at this specific eyeball right here. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, fourth row down, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 across. So if we look in our character palette, we're on row 4, and 6 across is not right. Ah, but if we pay attention with our eyeballs here, children, we can see that this is 0 indexed, and that means it's using hexadecimal format. Well, at least it is in this. So let's change the palette so we can make it better and easier to see. Ooh, and you can do that just by hitting F9. Now, let's find one that's pretty cool. Rusty Nuts. Commander. Ooh, that's like Norton Commander. Nortilities, like Norton Utilities, old school DOS things. What? They've got one like Impulse Tracker. Okay, it's on like Donkey Kong now. That's pretty awesome. So, but anyway, I'm going to go back to something that's a little easier to see. Like that one. That's a good one. Borland, which is like the Borland compilers, Turbo C++, Turbo Pascal,
Turbo Basic.
Anyway, so basically, let's try this. I'm going to use my white pixel brush here, and I'm not going to add any layers or anything. I'm just going to add, actually, I'm going to erase his eyeball. Let's try that first. One thing to note is the color mode in here is an indexed palette in the BIMP, bitmap, and then this is an option you don't need to worry about. There's also, yeah, 2 colors. That's important. It needs to be only 2 colors because it's only on or off. Making sense. So let's zoom way in here. Actually, let's give him, no, let's just erase his eye. Let's erase his eye there. Poor Eddie lost his eye. And we're going to do save as, and we're going to call this Eddie2.bimp. Now, if I open up this guy, you can see there's an eye there. But now let's import. Now, here's where things get kind of shitty, at least. Yeah. So you see, DOSBox, when it mounts the file system, it does so at the time it enumerates the contents of the file. So that's a downside of how this works. Like, I added it, but the notification didn't reach DOSBox that the file exists. So let's go ahead and close this guy. And it's fine because we have shortcuts. We'll just go back to our shortcut that we made, and we'll just reopen it. And as long as, now this opened in full screen mode, let me exit that. As long as, wow, that's really janky. Let me fix all my doodads. All right, so as long as the program is running from the same directory, which is here, and it should be, yep, because this is where we're working, this copy should now have that file. So if I do import Eddie2, hey, look, it's the same. Eddie doesn't have an eyeball. That is awesome. That is grandly awesome because look at what we just discovered. Theoretically, and I'm not suggesting that we do this, theoretically, we could use this 128 by 256 pixel graphic to create anything we want. There's no limit to this. We could do whatever we want. Ah, but we recall that there were other BIMPs. Let's take a look at some of those BIMPs. We've got the ATASCII one, so let's open that in Ace Sprite here. Okay, so let's see how wide he is. Okay, 128 by 256. Okay, let's set the grid up again. Let's do a 8 by 16, and look at that. Look at that. What this means is we can preserve, import, change, evolve in whatever manner we want with our own character sets. That's incredibly cool. Okay. Moment of silence and the pregnant pause for effect aside, let's go back to where we were before with how we're doing this. So if we take off this crazy man, okay, so we've got DOSBox, check. We've got Fontraption, check. We made a font. Okay, so this part we haven't done yet, but I have made a font and I'll show you. So Control L, load, and I made a few of them. I'll show you my most recent copy, which I edited. Okay, so now this is not a binary font. This is an XBIN, so I can't do it that way. But if I do Control I, I can load it that way. So this has characters that are in ANSI, but also have inspiration from Petsky. Now, I didn't do a perfect job of porting these. And to me, that's okay, because for one, I don't know how to do Petsky besides the few things that I've done. I made one more besides this that I've ever made, and it was an Apple computer thing. And anyway, point I'm making is this is my fourth one, right? So I'm not already kind of like, hopelessly addicted to this mode of these characters that are here. However, I am very inspired by them. So taking a look, we have one that's like this in Petsky. Well, I created something similar on mine. Now, it's very different here. And I think this is because this has I think this is an 8x8 or something. I'm not quite sure, but I think that's what's going on. So theoretically, then, if we were able to capture this font somehow and then convert it into the specific image size that we want, theoretically, that would work out for us, right? So let's just see. Well, here, the thing is, someone else has already done this. So let's do Control I, go to import, and actually it's not in there. Of course it's not, because I'm trying to show you. Right, let's exit this and I'll put it in there one moment. So what I'm doing is I'm going to copy a version of Petsky into this import folder that I have in my Dropbox from somewhere. So I already created the font for it. So let's put that in here too, just for topical references. I think where I got mine from. Yeah, here it is. I think I got mine from RexPaint. So I'm going to put this in the import folder. Ah, but you notice something. This actually, and here's GJ Scott. I have to organize my shit better because I've got stuff all over the place. Anyway, this is a PNG file, which is not loadable into our program. So let's really quickly use Ace Sprite and open it. And now, there's another issue here. We have a 256 by 256. Look at this too. We also have an alpha channel. This is an issue. So let's see if we can just delete that color. Okay. So now we've got two. Now let's see what mode we're in. Color mode is RGB. Okay. Let's go to indexed. Oof. Okay. So the order of operations matters here. Let's go to sprite, color mode, indexed. Okay. Now we can delete the color. Okay. And you just do that by selecting it and deleting it. Okay. Don't freak out. This is fine. This is fine. In an indexed palette, the first color in the palette is always transparent into a sprite. There might be a solution to fix this, but the one that I used before when I was working in this manner was, just move this guy up. I just took this guy and said, Where's he at? Where's my buckets? Fill. Oh, but it's filling transparently. Okay. Well, the way around that, first of all, let's do remap. Yeah, that doesn't make any difference. I didn't think it would. Actually, wait a minute. It did. It inverted it. That does matter. Let's try this again. All right. I'm going to go import. Actually, let's copy this guy over here. We're going to go grab him. Okay, so now we're going to go to sprite, color mode, indexed, fine. Then when we delete the transparent color, which is it's required, it's showing as transparency in a sprite. Now, if we choose remap at this time, we don't want that because it inverted the color spectrum. See, when black, do we want that? No, we do want that because we want the black, which is now, it's black over here, but it's actually transparent. We want the white on black at the top and then the non-inverted at the top and the inverted at the bottom, just so that we can be the same as these guys. We want the same thing. And actually, you can see that the layout's completely different also, right? So that's just the preferred way that the person who made this in RexPaint made his font or her font or their font. Okay, so now we've solved that problem. If we go to Sprite, color mode, we're in an indexed palette. If we go to properties, okay, we have two colors, but look, our width is different. First of all, let's try this together and see if it works. But second of all, if we go to File, Export, we want to save it as a BIMP. So we're going to call this Petski. Just Petski. And we're going to call it BIMP, Petski BIMP. We want no resizing. We want the visible layers. That's fine. All frames forward. We don't want any of this other stuff. Just export it. All right. So now, if we go back to our Total Commander and we relaunch our DOSBox Fontraption shortcut, we now have new files within there. Now, hopefully, OBS is still running. Yeah, it looks like it is. Because every time I go into that fill screen mode, I get a little nervous. Okay, so let's do Control I. Now, remember, we didn't change the width or the height. We kept it as is. Let's see what happens. Okay, the BIMP must be 1-bit color, 128 by 16. Okay, now that's not a deal breaker. We know we need to restart this. Let's close that. Let's go to a sprite, and we're going to do this. We're going to go to sprite, sprite size. In here, we're going to do that. Okay, and we're going to choose for the method, we're going to choose nearest neighbor because we want hard, chunky pixels. Okay, well, the aspect ratio changed. It definitely is conforming to the correct size that we need. So let's re-export it. And we're going to do it as a BIMP again. Export, yes. Okay, back to the Total Commander. Open up our Fontraption. All right, I'm going to change that shortcut because it's driving me a little crazy. Let me do that real quick, guys. I apologize about this. Okay. No full screen. Okay, and let's just test our shortcut. Bop. Yay. Okay, so now we should see, or we should have the ability to import our Petski BIMP. Look at that. Would you look at that? Now, here's a thing that I just noticed. All of these are inverted the wrong way that we don't want them. So that remap step is wrong. Don't do that. Don't do that. But what you can do instead is hold shift in the right arrow all the way to the end. Go down. Now watch this. Hit I. Ooh. Now you hit control D and you get it. Now it's showing a different color because we've edited it. Let's get our Borland back here. Okay, so now Control D will deselect. Trust me, it's deselected. And let's do this, and we're going to invert this one now. So the entire character set has been edited. That's why they're a different color. It's showing you that. Okay, so now we got this. Let's take it out of this program, petsky.f16. Yes. Okay. Now, I just realized everything I just did, fuck, is on the wrong. Oh my gosh. So I just realized that you guys were seeing the wrong thing this whole time. Suffice to say, I'm just going to go ahead and go. I'm going to edit the video and make it go fast through that part. I apologize for the oversight. Okay. So, right. So now we have Petsky in our wrapped program. We imported it from our conformed Petsky BIMP, but it's inverted. So what we want to do instead is select everything and go shift down. Ugh. Let's do this again. Control I, import Petsky. Okay. So I'm going to go over here and I'm going to do shift all the way down to almost the last line. Go over here to the last column and go down one. Now I'm going to hit I and it inverted all of those characters. Now I'm going to save this as petsky.f16. Yes. And I'm going to open my Moebius with the forked code base. I'm going to go to view, load custom font. And here is the Petsky. It turned it into Klingon. That's awesome. Here's the Petsky that we just made. So we can, now what we can do is draw in Petsky within Moebius. Now the thing is, if you look up at the top, it's using this six thing. This is something from the old days where the block characters that were auto-mapped or however they did it with their algorithm, six is the default when you open the program, okay? So if you go to view and you choose reset the default font, I'll show you what I mean. So it just did six there, and then it did the block characters. So everything got out of Klingon mode, and it's back to English. But if I go to view, and then load custom font, and I choose my Petsky font, now it's back in Klingon. That's fine. Look at this. We're still on six. But then the other thing I want to show you is control comma and control dot will get you through all of these different ones. There's 20 of them. And so we're going to go to one. We're going to go to back to six, and we're going to set our Petsky that we want for that. So I, as an ANSI artist, I want, nope, I don't want that one. I want the full block. Actually, no, I want the dithered block for that. And then I want F4, absolutely, because of muscle memory, I want that to be the regular block. And then, so that's really all the dither that you get. There's a few other options. I guess I should not just say that. Let's look at F3. There's a couple where you have one like this, which is actually really cool. So you get like this different effect there. There's a bunch of other ones that you can use for dithering, but they are basically the same. So instead, what I'll do is just create the inverse of that. So now I have F1, F2, and you can see it kind of connects there. So I don't think I'd ever use that. It would always be either F1 or F2, depending on what was above or below it. Okay. But what I'm showing you here is that you can remap all of this. So once you do this and you go through the painstaking process of remapping things, let's quit Moebius now. Actually, let's save our XBIN before we leave. Save as, this part's important, XBIN, and we're just going to call this curetest.xb. Okay, let's exit Moebius. To our total commander. Let's reopen our Moebius. Okay. So it forgot the zoom level. Or actually, it didn't. I think that was what I was in already. So that's not the program's fault. That's my fault. But look. So we're at six here. And I can't see because the light's in my face. I'm going to turn this off for a minute. F1, our font's gone. Okay, so let's load the file that we just saved. Care test. Ah, font is back. Everything is cool there. But look, guys, the mapping's gone. So that's something that sucks. That sucks a lot. That sucks a big pile of a big satchel of floppy phallic symbols. Okay. Because like now this program isn't really going to let me pick up where I left off. So either I can keep it on perpetually. I just thought of something. If you used VirtualBox and put Moebius inside of it, you could save your state and then reuse the state. So you wouldn't need to leave it on perpetually. But anyway, it doesn't matter because we're going to use Pablodraw. And the reason we're going to is because you can't change the colors in Moebius. Okay. So now we have done this. We have our care test. We have our PETSCII. Let's go ahead and open our Pablo guy friend here. And we're going to go and you see care test. First of all, that's great. You can see the characters are there. Let's edit it. Awesome. Now look down here. We're in the sixth position, which is the default. And this is from legacy ANSI stuff. But now let's change this. And we want this guy, F1. And then we wanted, I think, this guy. And then we wanted, I don't think it mattered, but we'll just pick what did we have else? Let's just pick a random, how about that one? And then we're going to put the most important brick is F4. So where is that on here? Well, I want it fully filled in. So it must be that one. Okay. So now we've set this up. Now when we edit, okay, we can get it an approximation of what we're used to. Oh, I also recall that we want that fat dither after. So let's find that guy. Is that it? I don't think that's it. This is it. Ah, but look, it put it on set one. I want it here, and I don't want a space. I want it there. So now I have F1, F4, F5. Okay, these are the characters I've decided I'm married to. I want those. So now I'm going to, well, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to change the colors to demonstrate. So double clicking on any of the colors in the palette will allow you to edit them. You can also use this rightmost button to summon the palette editor. Double click a color to change it. Note that most formats only support up to 16 colors except for Tundra and ANSI format. So we can have as many colors as we want, apparently. That's pretty awesome. I wish Moebius supported low-spec API and could just load colors. That would save a lot of time. So I'm going to double-click this one. I'm going to make it orange. Okay. Click OK. Now, we can't see them, but if we go here, we can. Now, the question is there a hotkey to switch through those? And there is. And it is Control-Left. You can't see it. It didn't move it, but it's there. And then Control up and down, right? Let's find our orange. Yeah. And you can just click it too. That'll save you some time. But Control up and down, Control left and right. So if I right click, Control left and right, now I can get an orange background. Now it's saying it's black. You have to go to use ice colors in order for that to work, just so you know. So now we're going to have this bright orange background with yellow text. And we're going to do F1, F3, F4, and F5. That, my friends, took a long time to explain, but you can't do that in this program. Remember, the quest was just to get the colors. Okay, so now we've done that. Let's save our file. And it's already an XBIN, so I think we could just do save. Okay, now what we realized in the other program was that our set was lost. So now let's click OK and exit. Now let's check in Pablo if the character set is gone. And if we go here, we go here. It saved it. It saved it. It's like a gift. Now the question is, if we open up a different file, what happened? Let's try this one. Okay, this is just an edit I made. Now, if we look, okay, so it saves your configuration, but it's not font specific and it's not file specific. All right, perfect. Now, so these are all boring colors. We can just change them. Double click the one that you've got here. Remember, this is an index palette. Bam. Bro. That's awesome, bro. Now, here's where some of the work comes in. And it looks like I already started doing this. I don't want it looking like I want to do it in a different way. And then also you use Alt F1, F2, F3, F4, F5, F6 to change the cursor or the colors at the bottom, the characters at the bottom. And then Control will get to the secondary palette. So there's still, if you look, there's 20 character sets. And I don't know if the hotkeys don't work here. Okay, that's fine. All right, so anyway, I'm going to do set defaults, and it's going to rock my world for a minute. Okay, so first of all, I didn't design my font properly in the way that I could just look at what exists there and make it so that the default mappings map to what I want. So because I didn't do that, and these are all the characters I want from my font, and I know this is my font because if I look at my font, which, what is this? Oh, that's a browser. This guy. Let's go back here, open this guy on top. All right. You're going to hell and you're going to die. All right. This guy. I'm gonna load my font. Right. I can't type. Sweet. Okay, let's just Control L. Dudes. Y'all got any more tab? I can't seem to tab. Oh, that's fantastic. So the keyboard doesn't exist here. Let's reopen that. All right. Let's reopen it. And then let's see if we have a keyboard. Control L. Tab. Perfect. All right. So this is, I think it's this one. Now I did L for load. I want to do import for that. Yeah, that's it. So, anywho, you can see the characters are the same as from my font in here. Okay, that aside, now I want to map them. So to do this, there's a couple different ways that you can do it. And let me show you what I'm talking about. So I want my first through nine rows to be set up like that. That's how I want mine. Okay. Like this. I want them to look like that. It's my Pablo. Bro. Pablo. That's probably because I had a modal open. All right. Let's do this again. But up. Okay. So I want mine to be like this. And it looks like, wait, this is a different Pablo. Wait. Help. I need an adult. Okay. No. I must have had multiple Pablos. Okay. I'm sorry. This is taking way longer than I anticipated it would. Okay. So now, okay. So demonstrating at the bottom, you can see the F6s are there. And my F5, F6, my F7, my F8. Those eight characters, or let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's technically what I've been using for however long, aside from like this once in a while, that maybe some Alt 254 action and stuff. So anyway, but now the world is my oyster. Okay, so my mapping's gone, part one. Part two, I know what I want it to look like because I went through this process and I created this thing. Okay, so I don't care about that. Make it stop. Go away. I guess it can't. Sidebar. Okay, this is Snagit. It's a separate program. Doesn't matter. I want this for one in six, but let's start with six. So first of all, if we look at row six, which is the default when you open the program, it's kind of funky. It's not what I want. It's right up into this part here, it looks like. I've got my F7 and my F8 there. What do I have after that? So there is also these round guys down here, round guys to create circles. So I want that, then that, then that, then that. Okay, I'm not going to do the whole font because it will drive you crazy if I do. But now if I do F1, F2, F3, F4, F5, F6, F7, F8, all ANSI that I'm used to, now I can draw circles. That's sweet. That is pretty cool. And if I do expand, oh wait. Well, here, I'll just do this. I'll make it the right size. View, zoom. I don't want to expand a fit because I want this sharp looking pixels. Okay, so but now you see that. So now the process is remap everything to what I want in the way that I want it. Or knowing what we know now, I could find and export the default, which is just VGA. We know from this guy. So if I do Control G, I want 8x16. Okay, now let's see if I can export this. So I'm going to export it as a bitmap. All right, and I'm going to call it VGA.bimp. Now, inside of our ACE sprite, let's import this guy, which is up here, VGA BIMP, and holy moly spicoli. Look at that. So why is this cool? Well, first of all, I gotta go here to change the color of the grid. Visible pixel grid, visible grid. I want the opacity to be higher. And I want this to be the active document. Apply, okay. Now you can't, yeah, okay. So I'm gonna go to edit, preferences. I'm gonna change my color to be, I don't want it to be white. How about 50% white? Which is a color that I can actually see. Okay, so now what I could do, because I'm a total dork, is I could go here, I can reset the defaults. Okay. All right, I'm picking up what I'm laying down. Let's get rid of all of these characters. Let's just use a text document with the default font. We're gonna open this guy up. This is what I want. This is the default for drawing in the Pablos. And I want to copy this with my Snagit. I'm going to copy it to my clipboard. And I think you know where I'm going with this, perhaps. But what I'm getting at, here, let me go back. Copy, and then inside of my, and then, I don't, hold on. All right, this is getting out of hand. All right, so if we go to drawing, and then NT, and then programs, and then contraption, and then default, Tableau layout.ping. Now what I can do is go from here, and then here, and then here, and then here. I gotta close that. And then here. All right. Yay! I can go flop, bleep, bop, chop, not flop, bop. Mm-hmm. All right. So basically, what I can do, if I am so inclined and I have the time, I can take what I've got going on F6, find the characters, and then map them with the fonts that I want, so I never have to map them, and they'll just work also in Moebius. That's a lot of work, and I don't think I'm going to do it. And yeah, it's not going to happen. What I am going to do is I'm going to import my my XBIN. Then, wait, this is the old one. One, I think. I made some edits. No, I want it from my Dropbox. Oh my god. All right, so never mind. But what I'm going to do is export my font as a BIMP. I'm going to call it gjski.bimp. And why am I going to do this? Well, I want to hide my layers, which is my timeline, actually. And I want to hide my colors because I don't need my colors right now. Actually, it's fine. It's actually fine. But what we're going to do is go here, and we're going to go grab disk. Got to grab it from the icon. Grab it from the icon, you crazy idiot. All right. Put up. All right. Now I have my font here. And I want it to be in the middle. That's mine. And it says that. You see where I'm going? Now I can kind of get my head in that. It's not lining up. There we go. It's close. It's close. So what I could do, oh, I'm still missing one. I need this. That will be on a different monitor. But the general idea that I'm getting at here, I would go through the process of saying, let's map this. So, okay, we'll do the circles because that's an easy example. Basically, what I want to do is change the default. I want to change where it's at in my character set to map against the default. Now, here's a neat thing that you can do. I don't think I need this in here. And the reason for it is because what I'm going to do instead is I'm going to move. Okay, I'm going to move that. Move this. Okay, I'm going to put Fontraption in the middle. That's where my art is. Okay, so set 6. If I change my character of where this little Mario fireball head plant thing is at with my. I do need this guy on a different monitor. Okay, I want the opening circle facing downward. Okay. I stop it. Okay. Right. So where is that? Well, here's the issue. I overwrote it. So we can't use this layout to find it. We have to use this layout. So if I look over here, it's the fireball head. Going through. Here it is. So it is at position. Let's see. We know we have 16 across. Right? 4. Yeah, 16 across. So that is. The 14th, 15th, no, that's the 12th, 11th, no, 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th. So this is the 11th, no, wait, this is the 13th, 14th, 15th. So that's the 13th one. So anyway, it's up. It's from the left to, it's from the right to an up one. So if I go into, hopefully I have. Is this, of course the tab key doesn't work. Something is stealing my tabs. Something been stealing my tabs. Well, anyway. Ooh, wait, look at that. Look at. You can have two open at once. That is amazing. So 1, 2, I don't need this now. Okay, I don't need that. So, yes. I can do instead that. Okay, so if I look at 2, it's here. Now, here's the question. Okay, now it works. Good. The tab works. So go here. Can I go to 1? Will it stay? It stays! Oh, look! It actually is correct. What I want. Wait, where's... Okay, yeah. So, This is ridiculously complex. It shouldn't be this way. Help! Someone save me. Save me from myself. Okay. Oh, this is stupid. Okay. So all we really need is this one anyway. So we don't even need him because he's a dick. He can go away. Don't save hims or hims. No. I said no. I just got done telling you no. How many times I got to tell you no? No. Oh, what happened? That's weird. Okay. All right. So now, in here, this is already set up properly, magically, and by coincidence only. Now, if I look here, oh, wait, maybe it's not coincidence. That one's that one, which is the right one. Now, F11 and F12 are wrong. So if I go, and I'm showing you this for a reason. So we need to find the N. That's down here. So the default is down there. Wait, it is that. Did I do it right just by luck? I don't think I did. I mean, maybe that got lucky, that first one. But I know for a fact. No, I know for a fact. Oh, wait, what is this? Oh, this is the Petsky one. Derp. Oh, my God. That's crazy. Okay, F6 is set up properly, actually, when I do set defaults. No, it's not. It changed to be that. Why? Why is that? What happened? Well, let's look. It's this. Wait. That one is what showed up where I thought it would be this. So I probably had the defaults already changed when I took that screenshot. No, I had a different font loaded, is what was going on. So if I go to 1, see, oh wait, this is a different font. I'm looking at, oh my goodness, this is a different font. This is the one I edited it. Edited? No, this isn't the one I edited. Oh my goodness. That's why I'm getting now confused. I think this is the right one. I promise ya, I have this here. All right, I'm just going to save. Wait, yeah, I'm just going to save this. GJ, ski, exclamation point dot F16. I'm going to load my Moebius. I go to view. Oh, custom font. That one. Good. And you can see that uppercase works here. Right, uppercase works, but you don't have lowercase characters. I chose to overwrite those for more flexibility.
Flexibility.
Okay, save as XBIN. And we're going to call this GJ ski exclamation point dot XB. Now, in Pablo, we're going to open this. GJ ski XB. Okay, now, I don't know. I don't have an explanation for that. Unless, wait a minute, cancel. Did I already map this in the Moebius? Oh, wait, guys. Well, actually, that doesn't make any sense because, actually, never mind, guys. You can see 6 here. So, actually, that's right. That's right. That's my old mapping. But it's the wrong font. This is down a pixel. So it's not my edited font, but it's the right mapping. So, well, except for 6. I did it back 1. No, 2. What the fuck did I do here? Where's my bars? 7 I started. Maybe? Or I don't have an explanation for this. I must have just not thought about this through all the way. But if I look here, it's different. It did capture 6. So this is the previous mapping that I had against the font. Anyway, you can do that. So we're getting way beyond what I thought would be necessary here. I've made a video that is so long that I don't help. Okay. Let's review. Okay. Wait, let's review. So we have, okay, you take your DOSBox, you download it, and then you create a shortcut. Then you download your Fontraption. Then you create a shortcut to it, to open it. From there, you load a font, or you make your own. You save it as a F something. You go into your Moebius that you get from a custom download area, and then you load it. You save it as an XBIN. Don't map your characters because it'll be lost. Then you take that and you load that XBIN into Pablodraw. And then in your Pablodraw, you then set up your character mapping for your font. Although know that you have a global mapping of characters for the entirety of your Pablodraw session ever. So if you ever change your font, you're just hosed unless you keep different copies of Pablodraw or virtual machine states. I don't know, but anyway. And then you can edit colors, and then you can also create goofy little characters and save it as XBIN. Okay, so it's a lot of work. It seems complicated, but it really isn't. It is, if you didn't spend the weekend doing this, it's complicated. But if you did spend your weekend doing this, it's not bad. So once you do the first one, it should probably be fine. Okay. Right. So I'm working on a new font, and I'll share it with whoever wants it. I don't remember even what's happening here. No, that's not it. Anyway, I'm working on a font, and it looks like this. So many things. I've done too many things here. So it looks like this. And I'm editing it right now to fix some of these issues, and that's why I said, hey, that's the wrong font. Anyway, long story short, too late, way too late. This font will be released at some point. And one of the things that I missed about Petsky in ANSI was the Petsky characters that I liked. And the other thing was I added these little half-height shaders. There's more to it than that. I'm adding some, you know, custom bar drawing things for text, but you can make some neat little things going on. You know, you can do little neat characters and things. It's fun. You can have that. All that work for that. Anyway, if you like this video, you're probably as sick as I am. And so this content on this channel is probably like your favorite content ever. Go ahead and subscribe, because I make it all the time. And, well, not all the time. I make it when I can. But when something sufficiently inspiring occurs, like what I just showed you. Right, so it's 2:30 in the morning, and I'm going away. I'm going to upload this to YouTube. Hopefully the audio is fine. and replace the existing video. Okay, bye.